Hello, I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE here at our NYSE CUBE Studios as part of our NYSE Wired program and community. This is the Crypto Trailblazer series where we are talking to the leaders who are making it happen in crypto infrastructure. As the world in finance infrastructure changes and stablecoins comes in, you're starting to see a sea change. A surge in entrepreneurship, a surge of new business models. Paul Frambot is here, co-founder and CEO of Morpho, morpho.org. Check it out. Paul, great to have you on this podcast. Thanks for coming on our Trailblazer series.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
We've had some pretty big names on, some older guys. You're a young gun coming in. You got a cool venture you're developing. I got a lot of questions, but first start out by explaining what you guys do. What was the origination story? How did it all come together?
Sure, so Morpho is a non-chain lending and borrowing infrastructure. So we allow people to earn yield on one end and to take out loans on the other end, right? And this is fully done on-chain on 20 different chains, and it's being integrated by mostly fintechs, exchanges, et cetera, that want to power yield or loans services, right? But they do so by plugging on-chain, and they get access to global liquidity, better terms by doing so, right? And the funding story is that I was a student in Paris, in Polytechnique, and essentially started playing around consensus algorithms, and that's what was my way into blockchain, and then crypto, and then DeFi, and then wanting to do a project in DeFi, and financing is obviously like a huge thing in finance.
Yeah.
And so I ended up working in this and got funded by some VCs, and that's how it
all. And who was the backers?
So Andreessen Horowitz initially and Nascent were like Invariant. Like we had a lot, like we had 100 different investors.
Yeah.
But that was a fun story. Back then I was like in my second year at university, so I did not know much about fundraising.
Come on, come into the fold. Andreessen Horowitz lured you in.
Exactly. You know? But that was a lot of fun. And then obviously the company has grown a lot since then. Yeah. We've done multiple rounds of funding, but that's how it
How much did you guys raise? Roughly, can you talk
like
about it?
Close to 100 in total.
Yeah, nice. Well, what's cool about this market is that it really is a young and old kind of coming together. It's not the old days. When I was your age, it was the young beats the old down to the ground and takes over territory. But in crypto, it's kind of like it's a blending of cultures.
Sure.
Okay, so as a young gun, I mean, you're like this in university. What's your feeling right now? Do you agree with that statement that it's kind of like a blending? I mean, you got the big gatekeepers. Now, they know they're going to get disrupted. They got to either accept or reject it. And some who reject it will probably be, you know, burned to the ground by the forces.
Right. So I think, you know, I've changed opinion over time with this. Like 2 years ago, like I think the crypto industry in general was a bit arrogant with regard to like the financial industry overall, thinking like everything was outdated and that they were going to disrupt everybody. And you know, over the last 6 months, we've clearly seen very important institutional interest. And what we've realized is that the people in traditional finance not only get it fast, but they also build very fast, much faster than we anticipated, right?
Yeah.
And within just 9 months, they've been able to integrate and educate their own like companies and people to the Web3 technologies at a pace I would never have imagined. I'm very impressed in general.
You know, I'll tell you from my perspective, seeing the many waves I've lived through, you know, the New York crowd or the institutional crowd, even globally, you know, they hold back because they control the money.
Right.
You know, they talk about money. When money's on the line, people change their behavior.
That's completely fair. And I think really the trigger, like what's interesting is that initially people were thinking, oh, they're going to get in for technology, right? But actually what made people get in was that the distribution, like there's a lot of money on chain and all those players were like, hey, let's tokenize our funds to get access to this capital. Let's run and manage vaults to be able to essentially make money out of it.
Okay, so let's get into some of the things you're working on. So obviously, well, congratulations on the opportunity. So I think it's going to be great. I think you're going to do well. It's so early. What are you targeting? Who's your customer? What's the focus?
Right. So Morpho is a $15 billion infrastructure in which like different types of fintechs, exchanges would integrate to offer yield and loan services. So one famous example of that is that if you're earning yield on Coinbase or if you're taking loans from your Coinbase app, behind the scenes, Coinbase is going to spin off a wallet, right? And this wallet is going to directly interact with the Morpho smart contract, right? And smart contract is going to be, this smart contract is going to be the connector between all those different front ends, and is going to aggregate liquidity in one single marketplace where everybody can draw from or earn yield on, right? So we integrate with Gemini, Crypto.com, Ledger, Binance, like all of those players, they all connect to this universal lending network that we operate on-chain and that is fully decentralized, that allows people to directly plug from. And so customers could basically be, if you have a crypto wallet, you can directly interact with the protocol, but most interestingly, it has become institutions and distributors themselves that want to offer yield on their crypto, but also on the USD and Euro accounts, right? And so more and more, anyone that's looking to integrate yield into their platform or loans is a user of Morpho.
So you're basically building a smart contract layer as a mechanism to manage the different other mechanisms. You're like an abstraction layer.
Yeah, so we connect lenders with borrowers. Like effectively what the smart contract will do is that it will account for the interest, who should be paying what is the liquidation threshold, like at what point people should be liquidated, if they have some collateral, et cetera, et cetera. And so a bank would use this to move their loan books on chain, for example, like we just announced recently, Société Générale is moving on chain with Morpho, where effectively what they do is they would lend out their own stablecoin in the Morpho books, and then they wait for borrowers to take those orders.
So if I'm a whale and I have a lot of Bitcoin, am I a prospect or am I have to go through?
So two main use cases. You can either earn yield on your Bitcoin on Morpho by making it available to borrow to some other people, or you can get some financing out of your Bitcoin. And so what you do, your use case, what it would look like is you deposit the Bitcoin in the smart contract and you take out some USDC, right? Or USDT or whatever the stablecoin you want, right? And with this, you can do you know, pretty much anything you want. Like whether it is like buying a house, taking on some leverage, repaying some credit line, et cetera. And obviously you don't have to interact with natively with the smart contract. You would usually do this for an app, right? That abstracts this for you.
You know, one of the things Mark Andreessen was very vocal about was the debanking during the last regime. So since the new regime in the U.S. is in place, liquidity was a huge problem, right? No banks. Now, you guys, that changes the game, right? That's
completely fair. And I think in general, when you start to see like all the things that are happening on chain right now, if you have a wallet, you have access to payments with stablecoins. So that's like your checking account. Now you have Morpho vaults that allow you to earn yield and through different risk profiles with all types of assets that can be productive. So now you have access to yield, but you can also take loans and you have those crypto credit cards now that are happening. And so you start to wonder, do I even need a bank account? And I think, you know, it's fair to say that we're going to see some fintechs emerge where they're able in just like a few days to spin off an app that's an entire fully fledged like financial app that gives you access to a breadth of financial products with immense liquidity and diversity of products for all types of users in a way that's very accessible.
What's your vision? How do you see this, you know, the preferred future state? If you can, you know, connect the dots with what you've seen, how you started, where you are now, where the market is. What's the vision look like? Paint us a picture.
I think blockchain enables us to have this open computer where everybody can operate in the same environment and create financial products in a very open fashion. And what openness enables is competition, right? Meaning that people that are going to be competing much more fiercely than in traditional finance, and so the take rate for end users is going to go down. So the prices of all those products is going to go down and the consumer is going to benefit a lot, right? The second thing is liquidity, right? Like there's going to be much more connectivity because the system is open. And so as a result, the depths of the pools of the trading books or the lending books is going to be much more important, and you're going to be able to take out very large loans at a very good price, right? And then finally, the integrability is extremely, extremely interesting because everything is open source, right? So it's going to be very easy for anyone to get access to those financial services because purely technically, it's very easy to do.
We've got the option closing behind us. That's the option floor. The bell rang at 4 o'clock. Now that's the option is now closed for the day. All the trades, a lot of red on the calls today, almost all red, actually all red, and a few greens on the tape on the puts. Obviously, the market's hot for crypto. You know, it's interesting about the NYSE. It's becoming the exchange of choice for crypto. It's almost similar to the NASDAQ during the tech bubble when, again, I was a little bit older than you, the dot-com bubble.
I wasn't
and,
born.
And you weren't born yet. and so Intel and those guys, they went to the NASDAQ. That this is because it was the young guns who were mercenaries. Now we're missionaries. Again, that's why I asked the question earlier. The NYSE is like the symbol of capitalism and financial systems. And this market in New York, crypto is going mainstream because of the one stablecoin. Clarity Act and Genius Act have been awesome. And that's, you know, setting the table a bit. I think there's going to be a tsunami of entrepreneurship in finance, tech, and infrastructure because of the, if it's a large computer, that's like NVIDIA. It's like AMD. It's like what we're seeing on the AI side. You basically have supercomputing capability that changes the software game.
Yeah,
so now you have programmability, you have programmable money. All these things were siloed in the past. Now it's like completely leveled.
Yes.
And now a new playing field emerges. That's why I think the young and old are coming in because money's on the table.
Yeah, no, 100%. And this open system is going to create so much more efficiency for everybody, much easier integration. And also another thing is effectively transparency. Like you can effectively see, like we saw through the market crash like a few days ago, DeFi did not suffer at all, right, from this. Like obviously there has been liquidation, but you know, very, very little bad debt from the lenders. And so effectively what we're seeing is a shift of trust from like the exchange, like the Binances of the world to like the DeFi systems.
Yeah. Paul, I have to ask you, because now that's going mainstream, I get this question all the time, and I also ask it myself. What chain do I domicile on? Where do I hang out my stuff on? What do I build on? That's one. The other one is, okay, I want to move all my money out of the bank into crypto. Who do I use? Do I use Coinbase? Do I use Binance? As someone who's kind of on the plumbing side of the business, and as all this kind of, I won't call it middleware, but that's an old term, but like as now these glue layers come in with smart contracts, we now have clean mechanisms for handling the fluidity of the cash.
Right.
What do I do? Where do I put my cash? If you, some retail person says, or a user.
Right.
What do you advise? What would be your...
It's a good question. So maybe first on the chain question, it depends if you're taking the builder perspective or the user perspective. From a user perspective, you should not care. The blockchain should be hidden completely from you through those fintechs and financial apps that should completely abstract it away for you. Unless you're tech savvy and you have your own wallet, in which case you can decide to go on Solana land where everything is fast and cheap, or you can go into the Ethereum community where you have a larger breadth of financial products and the systems are more, you know, battle-tested and decentralized, right? For developers, we are personally deployed on mostly, like, you know, the Ethereum ecosystem. Our code and smart contracts are compatible with Ethereum, but technically we're chain agnostic, so we could work with any blockchain. On the user side, you know, how do you use your money? Like, how do you park your money these days? I think it really depends, again, on how tech-savvy you are. Like, the ideal situation is that if you have your own wallet, and you're able to like use it through DeFi because this is where you get the least amount of intermediaries and be able to trade freely and also invest freely into a very large like breadth of financial products. However, if you don't feel comfortable with self-custody, which is a real challenge and really a pain to use, then I would recommend going through exchanges or fintechs that are particularly crypto-oriented.
Like who?
Like, so the Robinhoods of the world, you know, they've announced like the Robinhood chain. Apparently, they're going to settle everything on a blockchain in sometime in the future is a great option. Like the Coinbase of the world, like have a similar strategy. Crypto.com, Gemini, like etc. They all have a plan to interface directly with the chain and give the user the benefits of the chain. And coming back to our earlier discussion about banks, they're giving the full suite of products, like your credit card. They're going to give you loans. They're giving you yield. They're giving you trading on thousands and thousands of assets. And that's really without you know a banking license, right? So that's pretty great.
Well, the question that everyone wants to know that's on the builder side is, what's the secret sauce? What are you guys, what are you most proud of? What's the differentiator for you guys? What's going to make you continue to thunder away and innovate?
Yeah, I think, you know, for us, one of our biggest pride is like the quality of the smart contract, right, that we're building on top. Like DeFi is great, but we've had a lot of like hacks and troubles in the DeFi space, right? And I think one thing that, you know, the Morpho team is very reputable for is the quality of the code that we produce as the core engine for lending. And that's one of the things like we pride ourselves for. And then the other thing is most broadly like the enterprise adoption that Morpho has had recently makes it the very first like DeFi application that get fully enshrined and abstracted away by large scale platforms, right? So for the first time ever, you're seeing now in the likes of Coinbase like use cases where you don't get to see its blockchain behind the scenes. You don't see the wallet, you don't see
like a bank statement.
Exactly. But behind the scenes, so you have feature parity with all the traditional application, but you get the superpowers of Web3 behind the scenes that's going to give you more liquidity, better pricing, better diversity of products, et cetera, et cetera.
We cover the Ethereum community, Solana, all the top chains. Question for you is, what's the main area that needs the most improvement right now to continue to move the needle in the market? Are there areas that are people drilling away on, working hard on? What is the key focus areas that people need to work on, continue to iterate on?
I think at the chain infrastructure level, the three main things are always account abstraction, meaning how do you improve the user experience and the developer experience for those large platforms to be able to integrate seamless experiences. Scalability, which is like how do you drive the fees down, and privacy. Because right now, one of the biggest problem and the biggest blockers for large scale institutions to be able to integrate with traditional like financial products on chain is the privacy of the transactions, right? So if we really want massive scales, those things are the three main things. At the application level, so for the people building on top of the blockchain, what's very important is resiliency, modularity, right? Being able to have like a lending product that is not one size fits all, but more something that you can adapt for the risk profile of the platform, for the compliance profile of the platform.
What are some of the things you're looking at from the business side? Can you share any stats on metrics? How you measure the business?
Right.
Customers, give some examples.
Yeah, so I think, so Morpho currently we have $15 billion deposited in the protocol. Interestingly, this volume historically has been mostly DeFi native users. So people that had a lot of crypto that are like quote unquote whales that have their crypto wallets and the deposits into the different protocols. But the shifts happened like 9 months ago where we started seeing large scale enterprises integrating those infrastructure. And so what we track internally and what we get excited about is not the amount of money that we have in total, but more specifically, what's the volume coming from large scale integration, right? Because we believe this is what's going to drive the volume in the end, and that's what's going
to
be interesting.
Yeah, you're connecting to the institutions and the exchange is making all the money work. The money system.
Exactly.
It's a reboot of the money system.
Exactly.
And it's programmable.
Yeah, absolutely. And so for us, like the shift have been how do we move from B2C to like really B2B and like make sure we are fully abstracted away as an infrastructure embedded into all those financial apps.
All right, put a plug in for the company. Obviously, you're in Paris. You U.S. operations yet? Or
yes, we have 10 people.
You're hiring. Put a plug in.
Yeah, so Morpho, you know, we're a 60-person company across New York, California, and Paris mostly. We're very actively hiring on all fronts, from tech to like actually sales and institutional sales. Like one of the main reasons here in New York for the next 2 months is actually all the institutional interest has been tremendous, to be honest. And we need to bring in a lot of people to help us with that. So, yeah.
All right, Paul Frambot, he is the co-founder and CEO of Morpho. Again, the revolution went from damn the banks, damn the torpedoes, to now collaboration, because as mainstream money hits the system, and with the culture we're in now, it's pro-digital. And of course, digital transformation is happening in finance with decentralized. So this is what the Trailblazers are working on. I'm John Furrier, your host of Crypto Trailblazers. Thanks for watching.